the inaugural, the first Mark and Lynda podcast. And John Waite is joining us. John is right at my very best friend. And it was true, John. And
I love you, man.
Lynda and I were sitting with wine, and we were discussing what we wanted our first show to be. Did we want it to be, you know, without a guest? And it was Lynda who said, it's obvious that the first guest needs to be John.
Well, yeah. Hello, John.
Lynda, how are you doing?
I am great, thank you. How are you?
Oh, you know, the same, you know. Mark, how are you doing?
Johnny, dude, I've got a state-of-the-art studio in our home, and we're doing our first podcast, and I didn't have to get in L.A. traffic to get to the studio. I'm bitching, my friend.
Wow, that's great. That's really great.
Now, John is joining us today, and I told John when I called him about doing this, I said, now, Johnny, you know, we're going to get into some relationship stuff.
And
John said to me, he said, I'm always in favor of a little bit of honesty. Now, I got to tell you, the relationship that John and I have is twofold. One of the things that I love about my relationship with John is that I really can't stand small talk. And when John and I get together, we talk about real, genuine, down-to-the-heart stuff.
That's true.
Yeah. And we also have evenings of debacle. I'll tell you this one quickly. I was going to Morgan Freeman's Christmas party. I did some work for Morgan, so I was invited to his Christmas party. And so the party was going to be in Santa Monica, which is where John lives. So I let John know, hey, John, I got this party I'm going to. Join me at the Shutters Hotel for dinner. So John comes, and we start out with the cocktails, and they keep flowing. And I said to John, hey, do you think you might want to go to this party with me? And he said, yeah. So I immediately knew where this was going, and I ordered a car.
Downhill.
So
Downhill, my friend.
We finished dinner. The car comes. We continue drinking. We go to Morgan's party. We had the best time. We both got plastered. I go back to the Shutters Hotel. I go in my room. I prepared myself for bed. I got to get up and do the Mark and Brian program the next morning. I go to bed. I wake up the next morning. I was so out of it that I slept the entire night with my frickin' hotel room door wide open. And then we called John the next morning on the program, and John's quote I loved, he said, I woke up upside down.
Yeah, with my Doc Martens on. I mean, I didn't even manage to get my boots on. I mean, I staggered in, and it just went black. But a great night, though.
It was a great night. But we don't always do that. We do sit down, and we talk about a lot of things that are meaningful. We talk about things that a lot of people don't discuss, and it's one of the things that I like. So, John, for the first time ever, because whenever you were on the Mark and Brian program, it was still always kind of nice, and we never really kind of got into stuff. And Lynda's already warned me, John, she's not going to say a lot during this interview.
Oh, really?
Even though she's sitting here.
Well, I've been trying to, and I can't get
a word in.
No, not with the two of y'all.
Sorry. Apologies from both of us already.
It's okay. I knew this was how it was going to be.
Oh, no. Come on.
Now, John, let's begin at the beginning. Those of you that just joined us, this is the Mark and Lynda podcast. This is the great John Waite. In my opinion, this man, and he's very humble, and he always gets embarrassed when I start getting into it, but this is a guy that should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I want to go back, John, to the beginning. I want to go back to the days of the Babies. This group is held in such hugely high regard even to this day. And you and I have spoken on a couple of occasions. Let's listen to a second or two of this. This is John Waite and the Babies.
Every time I've held you, I thought you understood.
Man, I sound like I'm 10.
People say love like ours.
I mean, wow.
Will surely pass. But I know a love like ours will last and last. But maybe I was wrong, not knowing how our love should go.
Every time I think of you,
every single time,
it always turns
If you just joined us, we're talking with John Waite. We're discussing his days with the Babies. If you have a question for John or a comment, our toll-free line is 888-973-3971. Now, John,
yeah,
I've had a little bit of success in my radio career. And you and I talked about the Babies in that it's tough enough to go through a relationship with one other person. Needless to say, five guys. Now, the Babies hit big and hit early.
Yeah.
And the infighting in a band like that must have been crazy. But now, as a seasoned veteran, as you look back on that, what do you think you might have changed about the way you communicated with those guys?
Well, you know, I look back on it, and I have to say that I don't know how I managed it. I don't know what I did that was so adult. I mean, the guitar player wouldn't speak to me. And for like 5 years, we probably had like 30 conversations.
Now, why is that?
I have no idea. I never even got to know him. I mean, it was kind of like he was very remote and very distant. And if I was in a band with somebody like that now, I'd just confront him and say, you know, either be straight ahead or there's the door, you know. So it amazes me looking back on it how patient I must have been. Or maybe I was holding all the cards. I mean, to be fair about it, I don't really know, but I was writing all the songs. So I think it was probably, you know, jealousy, or maybe on both parts. I have no idea. I mean, it's... But you look back on that and you think, how did I, at 23, navigate through all of that craziness? But somehow, I guess the music carried us through. You know?
Well, uniquely odd that you talk about it in that way. When the Babies broke up, was it a nasty breakup?
No, it was when the second Babies broke up. We had the guitar player I'm talking about left the band, and we got two guys in, and we had a bass player, and I stopped playing bass, and we had a keyboard player, Jonathan Kearney, went on to join Journey. And at the end, we were just up against the world, really. And John went off and joined Journey, and it killed us, really. But it started to fall apart for the first time. Me and Tony, the drummer, were almost in fist fights and stuff, and there was a lot of silences and a lot of door slamming and a lot of, you know, I mean, I didn't know what was going on. I was just a singer writing songs, but we didn't seem to be going anywhere suddenly. I thought about it the other day. The last tour we did, it was half a house. You know, the places weren't selling out.
Mm.
And I think it came at a time, I had an accident on stage and bust my knee up, and that was the end of the tour, which effectively was the end of everything, really. But I told the band if we didn't start selling records, it was done. Yeah, I didn't want to end up playing down market. You know, we've done so well. I wanted to leave it on a high note, you know.
All right, so the Babies come to an end, and you then moved into your solo career, which brought...
Yeah.
Which brought some of the best work of your career with this song right here. And
missing it, yeah.
Yeah, and you were doing so well solo. Why did you then decide that you wanted to join up with yet another band, the supergroup Bad English?
Well, I think I'd made four albums, solo albums, after leaving the Babies. And I'd run out of things to say. I was becoming self-conscious. You know, I was getting to the point where I was writing about myself. And I was living in this big house in Westchester in New York and spending all my time in Manhattan, really. And I was kind of, I'd done it. I mean, I always wrote very kind of seriously. I never took anything lightly. I was very concerned with what I was trying to say and how I said it. And in fact, we've just done a live album, and I cut one of the songs, Wild One, that was on the last solo album. We did that on the live album, and I was amazed at the lyric and where the lyric went to and what I was referencing, and it was really a beautiful piece of work. But at the time, I couldn't see that. I was too close. And I'm in such a high standard, I guess, when you're trying to be a solo guy, it's the bar is raised. I felt I'd be better off in a band. I think that I am kind of very self-critical. And then I thought I just painted myself into a corner. I thought I'd try something that was the exact opposite. I thought that would push me into better work.
But John, you know, some of that nasty ugliness that showed itself in the Babies, as far as some of the infighting, showed itself with Bad English, did it not?
Well, you know, it's just two entirely different mindsets on making music. And they're great musicians. They really are great musicians. It's just that I take the writing... When you write in the first person, like, you know, one of your favorite songs is Masterpiece of Loneliness, you know. I mean, you couldn't write that in bad English. And you couldn't, because it's too dark. And it's very kind of suicidal, and it's really romantic. It's like country music. But that would be too much for bad English. You'd have to temper it. And in the end, I couldn't temper the work anymore. I couldn't be on the verge of something that was like really going to be a step forward for me, and then put it to one side just to keep the peace. You know, it was like democracies sometimes don't make great art, you know.
John, let's talk about what I really want to talk about. As I've said, the Mark and Lynda podcast is about relationships. And sure. I know that you have had many relationships with many.
Many. Well, now you mention it. Yeah, there's been a few.
Now.
Oh, my God.
Well,
yeah.
Look, for a guy like you, John, it is a vicious cycle, because I look at you as a broken heart. But look, here's the problem. The things that you've experienced in your relationships are what fuel your creativity as a writer.
That's true.
Some of the stuff that this guy has written, many of you have never heard. And John mentioned it just a second ago. I'm gonna stop talking for a minute, because I want to play for you a little piece of a genuine genius piece of music that this man that we're talking to right here wrote and performed. And I've asked John one time, when I'm at a live show, I want you to sing that. And he goes, Mark, the entire front row would commit suicide. I can't sing that. All right, so I want you to have that. We're going to play a little bit of this. This is John Waite. This is called Masterpiece of Loneliness.
Come home in the evening to the same old house alone, and in the silence of these empty rooms, I take shelter from the storm. But I bought a paint box and some brushes, baby, to pass the time since you've been gone. It's a portrait of a broken man, and the colors always run. A figure in a landscape. It's a work of art, you'll see. A figure in a landscape. It's a masterpiece of loneliness. That's me.
If you just joined us, this is the Mark and Lynda podcast. We're speaking with John Waite. Now, John, before I share one last piece of music and get you out of here, yeah. This next piece of music came off of your latest album, Rough and Tumble. And you get from John exactly what you think you're going to get. You get the rock and roll, and I love the rock and roll. The title track, Rough and Tumble, is phenomenal. But there is a ballad. This man that we're talking to, John Waite, is a master balladeer, as you just heard from Masterpiece of Loneliness. And he wrote a song, and I'm not going to share who it's about. I know, but that's private. This guy took the heartbreak of a relationship he just got out of, and he was able to put it down in words. And I asked John one night while we were having one of those meaningful conversations, why don't you write more often? And he said, because it's simply too painful. John, as you look back in relationships that you've had with women, is there a part of you that goes, this is where I screwed up? This is what I could have done better?
Yeah, I think... you know, I mean, we are in some deep water here, and it's very personal, but I would say that when you fall in love with somebody, the threat to yourself is enormous. You find it in women. When women fall in love, they start to back away. And because the cost is just, you know, that what's on the table is enormous. It's your life, you know. And that's why I think a lot of, there is such a lot of heartbreak in relationships, because when you're playing for keeps, unless you've got the exact right personality to contact that person at all times, you know, emotionally, it'll just blow up. It's self-preservation, you know. And I think that if you love somebody, you should just tell them. And I think keeping quiet or trying to be guarded is really the wrong thing to do. I have to say, your relationship with Lynda is a wonder to me, that you're so in love with your wife and that your wife loves you and that you have great kids and you've made it all work. I think it's a fantastic thing. I've had a very happy life, really. There's a couple of things that blew up in front of me that brought me down at the time. But it gave me some great stuff to write about. And I believe in love completely. I might go to the shop today and bump into somebody and my life turns, you know, 360. Who knows what's going to happen? But it's just that I think everybody goes through it. Bruce Springsteen said everybody's got a hungry heart. You know, everybody's been messed up. It's just rites of passage. If you don't get messed up, what kind of person are you?
Well, it kind of goes what I said, because for John and for people that are of a genius talent.
Well, man, that's incredible of you to say that, but I appreciate it.
Well, one of the things that
I... Say it again if you want.
I'm talking to a genius.
Oh, my God.
Well, yeah. John yeah. stepped out of a relationship that quite literally floored him. And we've all been there where the breakup comes and we are devastated. The other person seems to be kind of okay. And John wrote this song that the moment that I heard his album, this is the one piece of music that absolutely floored me, because I said, John is a master balladeer. But those of us that have been in that scenario where we do the breakup, we're devastated, they're okay, and then comes that phone call from that person. And I want you to listen to the lyrics of this. And I didn't choose John's version. I chose the cover version by a country group called Love and Theft.
Love them.
Yeah. And they're going to probably hit. They're going to probably hit number one with this. But I want you to listen. Because in the lyrics, John perfectly wrote this phone call that comes where the guy that's devastated is saying all the things that he thinks he should say. But in his head, he's thinking about the way it actually is. This is called If You Ever Get Lonely.
Thanks for calling. It's so good to hear your voice, but you keep breaking up. And all the static and the noise, but I keep a listening. 'Cause I never had a choice when it came to you. I'd love to see you. If you're ever out this way, you sound happy. Guess things are working out okay, and I'm getting better. I put in one foot in front of the other. And I know that California ain't to blame. And I know there's tons of people in LA. But if you ever get lonely and you miss me, if you need someone to listen, even if it's only the sound of someone's voice who loves you, that you need to hear, you know where to find me if you ever get lonely.
Well,
I can't believe you played that. That's so great you played that version.
Oh, it's, you know, I could have gone with yours, which I love, but
No. That's at its moment. But I think they're going to do, they have number one single with their first single, Rebel Eyes.
Yes.
They're nominated for the Duo of the Year in country music.
Yes.
They're up against Big and Rich and I don't know, somebody else that's really big. So they're in with a shot, but there's only three people been nominated, so we'll see what happens.
Well, John, I mean, look, as we said, the Mark and Lynda podcast is about relationships. Relationships are where we live. Are you ever going to be a guy that can settle down and get married and have kids and live a domestic life?
There's nothing I want more. I think I was, I almost got married a couple of years ago again, and I was set for parenthood, really. I was going to give everything up and just do that. I probably wouldn't have toured again or made the last album. I think we all want a home. I mean, no matter what we say. I don't think I'm so crusty and beat up with the world that I don't, think it's going to happen. But you never know. I mean, you really don't,
John,
I got to tell you a story. Quick. Yeah. Tim was doing some work on his house, and he was, my bass player Tim Hogan,
right.
And he's got like the full outfit on. He's got the working man's tool belt, the whole thing is covered in crap and plaster and cement dust, right? And he pulls up at a light yesterday, and Brian pulls up next to him in a black Range Rover.
Yeah,
and there's this uncomfortable sort of like 5 seconds where they look at each other. and then the light changed, and Tim just drove off. He just couldn't be bothered to explain what he was doing, covered in shit, But I just had to tell you the story, because I just found out this morning. It made me laugh.
Well, speaking of that, I have to share another story dealing with Brian and his black Range Rover. I was late one morning for the show, for the Mark and Brian program. I'm on La Cienega. I'm going to be late. And our bumper music is playing at the top of the hour. But I'm kind of okay, because I'm sitting three lights away from the radio station. And I'm okay, because I know that Brian's there, and he's going to take it, and he'll talk until I get there. So I'm okay. So I'm sitting at the red light, and then next to me pulls up a black Range Rover, and I look over, and it's Brian.
Oh my God.
Wait a minute. John, we're going to take one phone call before we get you out of here. This guy is one of our top members in markandlynda.us. We're going to take his phone call. He wants to speak with you. With us is Greg Stanford. Good morning, Greg.
Good morning, Mark.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, John. Pleasure to talk to you. Lynda, not so much.
Hey.
Just kidding. Great. Loving the show.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.
Yeah, John, I saw you with the babies at the Coliseum back in July of 80 for a summer blowout.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. It was great.
Like 110 degrees, Journey, Black Sabbath, Cheap Trick, Molly Hatchet.
Yeah, I remember that. It was a great show.
And the great thing about that is nobody wanted to listen to the babies, so we were able to push right to the front of the stage.
Oh, is that a backhanded compliment? Slash was at that show.
Yeah, Slash, I had a question. I think in 1984 you released, it was on Laserdisc back then, believe it or not, No Breaks Live Tour.
That's right, yeah.
Has that ever been ported over to DVD? I've never seen it on available.
I have no idea about that. I mean, it came and went pretty fast. We just did a live album in Philly again for some strange reason. I forgot about doing that in Philly. We did that at the Tower Theater. But we just did a live album in South Philly. I'm leaving to mix it on Wednesday, so things go full circle.
John, joining us real quickly, and then we're going to get you out of here, our producer, Jordan Ryan. He's been watching the chat room from markandlynda.us, and asked him just to step up. What is the chat room saying, Jordan?
They are eating it up. They're loving it. It's really unbelievable. There have been a few bad words said about you, about me, about Linda. They hate us. They love John.
They love John.
They love John.
Let's not forget Brian.
I had to brush a few pairs of panties off my laptop to resume chatting. Oh, my God. Wow. They're going nuts. Yeah.
Hey, John, let me ask you quickly.
Yeah.
Look, for those of us guys that are never going to experience it, when you're the lead singer of a worldwide hit band, whether it's solo, whether it's the babies, you're uncommitted, is it what we regular common guys like to think? Are you just knocking out 5-6 pieces of pussy every single night?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. What else you got?
John,
I'm just talking to you. I do. It's great. It's great to talk to you again. I mean, since you've been away, it's been kind of like very quiet around here.
Well, Johnny, look, it's as I told you, you've got to come see us.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely.
And on behalf of Lynda, thank you so much for being our very first guest. We love you, and we want to see you
too.
Soon.
I love you both. You're a beautiful couple, great kids, man. You're one of my all-time favorite people in the universe. God bless you.
Johnny, his new album is Rough and Tumble. Grab a copy and enjoy. Johnny, we'll speak soon.
God bless you. Bye-bye.
Bye, John.
See you.
Bye-bye, Lynda. Bye-bye.
All right, we will come back and set up tomorrow's program.